Okay, are you able to hear?
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Yeah. You please mute yourself. I'm not going to mute anybody. You please mute yourself. So today we are going to discuss about three hormones, that is parathyroid hormone, calcitonin, and as well as later on a little bit in brief about the insulin. So insulin in detail, I'm going to discuss in another topic. Let us concentrate on parathyroid and calcitonin and as well as insulin. First, let us discuss about the parathyroid and calcitonin. And if you want to understand the parathyroid and as well as calcitonin, you have to understand two different types of cells which are present on the base of the every bone. One is osteoblast and second one is osteoclast. And both these bones are concerned with the construction of the bone and as well as the destruction of the bone. Osteoblasts are concerned cells which are responsible for bone formation. That means it will add the components which are required for the bone, like calcium, phosphorus, magnesium, etc. And it constructs the bone. So basically it is concerned with the construction of the bone. And as it is understood that when the development of the bones are there, these cells are dominating. Next cell is osteoclast. So these cells which dissolves the bone, that means it will break down the bone and it removes the calcium and as well as phosphorus deposition from the bone. And constantly these two will be in the equilibrium. That means one cell will try to remove the calcium and phosphorus from the bone, and another cell will try to construct the bone. Then is it necessary? The next question is why these two cells are required. And of course, both the cells are synthesized in the bone marrow. I think you might have studied about you heard about erythropoiesis. That time we discussed about the pluripotent hematopoietic stem cell. You heard about WBC. Same like that, in the bone marrow, these two cells are synthesized, and then they get accumulated in the base of the bone. And any bone which is weaker and as well as which is withering, in such type of bone, this osteoclast will be dominating because it is concerned with the breakdown. And any bone which is in the constructing mode, osteoblast is dominating. Constantly, please mute yourself. And both osteoblast and as well as osteoclast, they will be in equilibrium. So that means these two cells, they are actually not in active form. That means some other hormones are still.
Sir, we cannot hear you, sir.
Now are you able to hear?
Yes, sir.
Then you mute it. So many people are, whether you are able to hear now, you are not able to hear now or from the beginning? Hello?
Sir, we can't hear you now. From the beginning, we could hear.
Now you are, you now are you able to hear?
Yes, sir.
Okay, then please mute. Here the thing is, so many people creating nonsense in the group here. So you can see that the osteoblast are concerned with the construction and osteoclast are concerned with the breakdown. So you, this concept, you keep it in memory here. So because next slide again, I'm not going to discuss about the blast means construction, clast means it is a breakdown. Now you just go through this particular slide. Repeat again. Blast is what you can say construction, and as well as clast is what you can say breakdown. Now parathyroid hormone, it is going to attach to the blast. So that means construction part. And the receptors required for the PTH, that means PTH cannot bind to clast. It is understood. If receptors are available, definitely it can bind. But the receptors concerned with the parathyroid hormone are not available in the clast. So parathyroid hormone, it will go and attach to what you can say, blast. And this blast, it will communicate to clast cells. That means the cells which are concerned with the destruction. Blast means the cells which are concerned with the construction of the bone. Clast means the cells which are concerned with the breakdown of the bone. Actually, parathyroid hormone, it is concerned with the breakdown of calcium from the bone. But receptors are not available in the clast. So it will bind to blast. So that means construction part. And this blast, it will communicate to the clast about this information from parathyroid hormone. I repeat again, parathyroid hormone will bind to blast because receptors are available for the binding of parathyroid hormone only in the osteoblast. And this blast will communicate to clast cells. And this clast cells, it will communicate to bone, it will promote or it will activate the bone resorption. That means breakdown of the bone. So once the clast is communicating to the bone and bone starts to, what you can say, release the calcium and as well as phosphate. Continuously, the calcium and as well as phosphate will come out of the bone. So once it comes out of the bone, the only area where it can go is the blood circulation. It is moving into the blood circulation here. You can see that. So I repeat again. So PTH cannot bind to clast because receptors are not available. It will bind to blast. And blast will communicate to clast, and clast will communicate to the bone and activate the bone resorption, that is breakdown of the bone, and then the calcium and phosphorus will enter into the blood circulation. Now calcium is rich in the blood circulation. One, then actually you should get one doubt. So how come this PTH, that means parathyroid hormone, is activated? That means parathyroid hormone is released from the parathyroid gland. So why it is released and how it is released? Parathyroid hormone is released if the parathyroid hormone is released into the blood circulation, means it is understood that calcium level in the blood is low. When calcium level in the blood is low, then the PTH will come out of the parathyroid gland and enters into the blood circulation. When calcium levels are high in the blood, then parathyroid hormone will not be released into the blood circulation. So that means what you have to understand, the triggering factor for the release of parathyroid hormone into the blood circulation is low levels of calcium. That means when low levels of calcium is there, parathyroid hormone is released. Then you have to understand one more point. If calcium levels are very high in the blood, then it is understood that calcium will not allow, high levels of calcium will not allow the parathyroid hormone to be released from the parathyroid gland. That means high levels of calcium is the inhibitor. That means it is an inhibitor for the parathyroid hormone. Low levels of the calcium, it is a stimulator for the parathyroid hormone. That means parathyroid hormone is released here, it came to the bone, So because the calcium levels are very low in the blood, then the parathyroid hormone will come and attach to blast, and blast will communicate to clast cells, and then it will promote the bone resorption, and the calcium and phosphorus is what you can say came out of the bone and enters into the blood circulation. Now calcium levels in the blood is very high. Once the calcium levels are high in the blood, then obviously the calcium will start to move in the blood circulation and enters into the kidney. So this portion, this rectangular portion, is a kidney. Now calcium entered into the which one? Kidney. That means the blood will carry the calcium into the kidney, calcium and as well as phosphorus. Then parathyroid hormone, what it will do, it will not allow this calcium to get excreted out from the body. It will promote the reabsorption of the calcium again into the blood circulation. But parathyroid hormone, it will sacrifice the phosphate and it will promote the excretion of the phosphate, but it will promote the reabsorption of the calcium into the blood circulation. It will not allow the calcium to get excreted out from the body. That means you have to understand that parathyroid hormone, always it will try to maintain the high levels of calcium in the blood. And it compromises for the phosphate. Phosphate will get excreted from the body. Not only this function, one more function is there for parathyroid hormone. What it will do, it will promote the synthesis of calcitriol. What is this calcitriol? So this is the active form of vitamin D. So I think you heard about the 25-hydroxycholecalciferol, which is actually synthesized in the liver from the skin. You heard about UV rays. When it is your body, if you exposed to the sunlight, then automatically vitamin D will be synthesized. That's what you studied in your earlier classes. But actually vitamin D will not be synthesized in the skin. So it is the precursor will be synthesized in the skin. And that precursor will enter into the liver, where one hydroxyl group will be added to the, what I can say, precursor. So thereby it forms, that means it leads to the formation of 25-hydroxycholecalciferol. Then this 25-hydroxycholecalciferol, it will enter into the blood circulation, it reaches the liver. Once it reaches the liver, then parathyroid hormone, it will promote the addition of one more hydroxyl group into 25-hydroxycholecalciferol. That means at the number one position. So thereby, you will get another product called as 1,25-dihydroxycholecalciferol. That is nothing but called as calcitriol. That means you no need to write everything, but actually you should have a clarity that how active form of vitamin D is formed. So the precursor of vitamin D will enter into the liver, into the kidney. That is nothing but 25-hydroxycholecalciferol. And that precursor will get converted into calcitriol. That is the active form of vitamin D. Chemically, calcitriol means 1,25-dihydroxycholecalciferol. That is nothing but calcitriol, and it is the active form of vitamin D. So finally, what you have to understand, the activation of vitamin D will take place in the kidney. And for that activation, you require one particular hormone called as parathyroid hormone. So parathyroid hormone, it will promote the addition of hydroxyl group into the precursor of vitamin D. And thereby, you will get the active vitamin D, that is nothing but calcitriol. So once calcitriol is formed, it will come out of the kidney, enters into the blood circulation, it reaches the GIT. It will come to GIT. Particularly, you heard about duodenum, small intestine. It will reach the duodenum. In duodenum, what will happen? So calcium absorption, that means calcium, it cannot be absorbed that much easily because it is a positively charged. So absorption is not that much easy. So for example, to promote the absorption of the calcium, you require this vitamin D, that is in the form of calcitriol. So it reaches the intestine, it promotes the absorption of calcium, that means whatever the calcium you consumed through diet, that will get absorbed in the presence of calcitriol. So once the absorption of calcium takes place, this calcium will enter into the blood circulation, it reaches the blood, that means bloodstream it will enter. Thereby, the blood calcium level will increase. So that means indirectly, parathyroid hormone, it is promoting the, what you can say, it will promote the increase in calcium level by activating the vitamin D. And this activated vitamin D, it will promote the absorption of the calcium in the intestine. And once the calcium is absorbed, it will enter into the blood circulation, the calcium level will rise. I think you understand the concept here. Any repetition is required? This one? I repeat again. Any repetition is required? Are you able to understand?
Yes, sir. Yeah. One.
This one? This part? Do you want this part?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So again, I repeat. Calcium and as well as phosphorus will enter into the kidney. So through blood circulation. So what parathyroid hormone will do, it promotes the reabsorption of the calcium. And when it is promoting the reabsorption of the calcium, it will sacrifice the phosphate. So phosphate will be eliminated or excreted in the form of in the urine. So that means only calcium will get reabsorbed by the parathyroid hormone. This is the first function of parathyroid hormone. Sorry, second function of parathyroid hormone. One is it will bind to blast. It promotes the, what you can say, bone resorption and promotes the breakdown of calcium, and calcium enters into the blood circulation. That is the first function. Second function is the blood will, the calcium in the blood will enter into the kidney, and calcium reabsorption is promoted by the parathyroid hormone, and it sacrifices the phosphate. Phosphate will get excreted from the which one, in the form of urine. Then another function of parathyroid hormone is it will synthesize the calcitriol, that is the active form of vitamin D. So initially, that means the inactive form of vitamin D from the liver, it will reach the kidney. So we heard that when you expose our body to the sunlight, so automatically vitamin D will be synthesized. You heard about ergocalciferol, etc., etc. But actually that is not active form. The inactive form of vitamin D from the skin, it enters into the liver. Through blood circulation, it will go to the liver. So in the liver, what happened? The liver will donate one hydroxyl group to the inactive form of vitamin D. It will produce one product called as 25-hydroxycholecalciferol. And that product from the liver, it will come to kidney. So once it comes to the kidney, this parathyroid hormone, it will promote the donation of one more hydroxyl group to the 25-hydroxycholecalciferol. And it gets converted into 1,25-dihydroxycholecalciferol. That means one more hydroxyl group will be added to 25-hydroxycholecalciferol, leading to the formation of 1,25-dihydroxycholecalciferol, or it is called as, it is also called as calcitriol. This is the active form of vitamin D. Actually, this vitamin D, what will happen from the kidney, it will enter into the blood circulation and it reaches the GIT. That is particularly, I'm talking about small intestine. Once it enters into the small intestine, it promotes the absorption of calcium. Calcium, if it wants to get absorbed into the body, it requires the help from the vitamin D. So this vitamin D from the kidney, it goes to the GIT and intestinal layer, intestinal lumen, and promotes the absorption of calcium. So that means when I am saying that it promotes the absorption of calcium, obviously the calcium will enter into the blood circulation. So indirectly, not directly, indirectly, parathyroid hormone, by stimulating the calcitriol or by promoting the synthesis of calcitriol, it increases the calcium level in the blood. So finally, parathyroid hormone, it increases the calcium level by three models. One is by breakdown of the bone, it increases the calcium level in the blood, and by promoting the reabsorption of the calcium from the kidney, it promotes the, it increases the calcium level in the blood. And third one, indirectly, by stimulating the synthesis of calcitriol, and thereby the calcitriol will increase the absorption of calcium, then it promotes the, or it increases the calcium level in the blood. This is about the parathyroid hormone. Then where is calcitonin in here? So you cannot see any calcitonin in here. So calcitonin, it acts exactly opposite. What it will do, just now I told that the clast will promote the resorption of the bone, breakdown of the bone, and thereby the calcium will move out of the bone into the blood circulation. Exactly opposite is calcitonin. Interestingly, the calcitonin will not bind to blast. It will bind to clast. I repeat again, calcitonin will have the receptor in the clast, not in the blast. By binding to the clast, what it will do, it will inhibit the bone breakdown. That means it promote, it will not allow the calcium and as well as phosphate to enter into the blood circulation. So thereby, it blocks this particular pathway whereby the calcium and phosphate cannot enter into the blood circulation and bone will not get destroyed. So it will be intact. That means what is the stimulation for the, which one? Calcitonin. Just now I told that earlier, PTH, that means parathyroid hormone, will be released into the blood circulation when there is low calcium level. Similarly, this calcitonin will be activated when high levels of calcium are there in the blood. Then automatically calcitonin will get activated. It will come and attach to the clast, and then it will not allow the calcium resorption from the bone. This is how. So both the parathyroid and the calcitonin will control the, what you can say, level of the calcium. Actually, if you observe, you think that, is it that much significance is there for this particular hormone? That means just it will promote the, control the calcium level in the blood. It is extremely important, very, very important concept here. So So little bit high levels of calcium or low levels of calcium are extremely complicated to the body. So these two hormones, and it will play in tandem. That means either any one will be activated and it tries to control the load, what is the level of the calcium. Consider abnormally high levels of parathyroid hormone is there. But the thing is, like out of the record, I cannot like talk now, but actually when abnormal high levels of parathyroid hormone is there or abnormal thyroid hormone is there, both thyroid hormone and as well as parathyroid hormone. You remember one more point. In the thyroid hormone, I told you that thyroid hormone also, it will promote the resorption of the bone. It will break down the bone. It promotes the calcium entry into the blood circulation. When abnormally high levels of calcium is, abnormally high levels of thyroid is there and abnormally high levels of parathyroid is there, that means it is understood that abnormally high levels of calcium will be present in the blood. When abnormally high levels of calcium are present in the blood, then it is understood that the calcium is not excreted out from the body. It will be retained in the body for a longer period of time. Then this calcium, it will go and block the small arteries present in the blood, in the body. So where you can expect a very small capillaries, definitely it is heart. So heart contains, the artery size in the heart is very, very narrow. And it is understood that excess amount of calcium, it will block this particular artery. Then, or otherwise, two options are there. One is heart, or second one is lower limbs. So you heard about foot, little finger or second finger or something. So it will go and get deposited in that particular area. What will happen? So like if it, what you can say, it enters into the heart, it blocks the arteries in the heart, then it is understood that the person has to undergo the surgery, heart surgery. And if it is deposited in the lower limbs, then it is understood that the person is suffering from gangrene. I think you heard about gangrene. So people who are highly, what you can say, those who consume a lot of amount of alcohol and diabetic patient, they suffer from gangrene, gas gangrene. So it is, there is no other option. We have to amputate that particular area. That means you have to remove the finger or leg or etc. Because circulation to that particular one particular part of the body is restricted because of the deposition of the calcium. So we can't do anything. Only option is we have to remove that particular part of the body. So it is deadly. That means hyperactivity of the parathyroid and as well as which one, thyroid hormone, and associated with the diabetes. That means diabetic patient suffering from high concentration of parathyroid or thyroid, definitely it will be deadly. There is no doubt about it. That means it is understood that if poor people who suffer from hypothyroidism, this complication will not be there. People who have high levels of parathyroid hormone, this complication will be there. So that means there is no advantage, there is no disadvantage. Nothing is good and as well as nothing is bad. So one hormone is dominating, it means that it may be advantage at one particular area, but it will have an equal disadvantage in another area. So this is about the parathyroid and as well as calcitonin. So next we are going to discuss about one more hormone examination point of view, that is insulin. Partly I am discussing, then glucose transport I am not going to discuss. So I have to check whether that particular question is there in the question bank or not. If it is there, then I will discuss later on. You heard about pancreas and as well as insulin. So insulin is like awesome hormone, extraordinary hormone, what we can say. So why it is extraordinary organ, pancreas, and why this insulin is extraordinary hormone? Reason is very simple. This pancreas is like, it is a gland, and it is a, what you can say, both exocrine gland and as well as endocrine gland. So already exocrine secretions we have not discussed because we have not discussed till now about the digestive system. Next chapter we are going to discuss, or maybe last chapter. So pancreas, it will produce digestive juices and as well as it produces hormones also. That means it produces exocrine secretions and it produces endocrine secretions. So here we are not going to discuss anything about exocrine secretions. That means the digestive enzymes produced by the pancreas, I am not going to discuss. That we will discuss in the digestive system. So here I am going to exclusively discuss about the insulin. Why this hormone is special? If you go through the pancreas organ, that means nobody will concentrate on that particular area. 98% of the pancreas, that means it is divided into two portions, that is exocrine portion and as well as endocrine portion. Endocrine portion, it composed of three different types of cells or four different types of cells, like alpha cells, beta cells, gamma cells. You heard about islet of Langerhans cells. So these are the endocrine cells. What is interesting is the endocrine portion of the pancreas is only 2% or maybe 1% also. Only 1%, 1 or 2%. The exocrine secretion, exocrine part of the pancreas, it occupies nearly 98%. That means huge. So in spite of only 1 or 2% of the pancreas, that means this islet of Langerhans, beta cells of islet of Langerhans will produce the insulin. Just hardly maybe 0.5% or 1% of the cells. What I can say, pancreas will contain only 0.5 or 1% of the cells of beta cells of islet of Langerhans. That means you just imagine very, very, very small quantity of insulin will be produced by the pancreas. That means 1%, you just imagine how much insulin will be produced. At 1% or maybe 0.5, 1 to 0.5 to 2% of the secretions which is produced by the pancreas, it is able to give answer to nearly some 20 different hormones. I repeat again. So this one insulin is able to give answer to nearly some 20 or 25 different hormones. What is the answer? Answer is nearly some 20 to 25 different hormones, what we discussed, what are available approximately. We are not discussing each and everything, but all these hormones, whatever the hormones are available, all these hormones, they increase the blood sugar, they increase the blood glucose level. All the hormones except insulin. Insulin is the only hormone which decreases the blood glucose level. That means one hormone is in one side, nearly some 20 different hormones in another side. One hormone is trying to decrease the blood glucose level and all the hormones is trying to increase the blood glucose level. And so you can imagine that how strong this insulin is. So abnormally strong, superb hormone. But the thing is, now I think you know that number of diabetic patients are increased. Sugar levels are increased in the blood circulation. So many people are suffering from diabetes, type 1 diabetes and type 2 diabetes. So whom to blame? Whether we can blame the insulin? Almost I can say that number of, if you consider the number of diabetic patient, nearly consider 100 patients are there. Almost 99.9% of the diabetic patient, the blame entirely goes to the individual, not to the insulin. Insulin is not responsible for the diabetes. That much I can tell. So when you are a diabetic, the whole and sole responsibility is you only, not the insulin. Insulin is doing its work. So then why this diabetes then? So like why more and more number of people are suffering from diabetes? That is totally different concept. Definitely I will discuss after some 6 or 7 classes, I'm going to discuss that. That is a different concept. We cannot discuss that concept under here. Why? Because you will try to incorporate those informations in the answer. So you are not supposed to do like that. So that's why exclusively what is required for examination that I am going to discuss in the insulin here in this particular topic. So this, you know that it decreases what you can say blood glucose level. That is actually wrong terminology. We are not supposed to tell like that. It promotes the movement of the glucose from the blood to cell. That is actually correct sentence what we are supposed to do. So it promotes the movement of glucose from the blood to cell. Then when we say that it promotes the movement of the glucose from the blood to cell, and it is understood that your cell should accept that glucose. Just insulin is trying to push the glucose from blood to cell. Like, it doesn't make any sense. Your cell also should accept that particular, what you can say, glucose. So when it fails to grab that particular glucose molecule, then we can't do anything. Now the problem is very simple. When this insulin is released into the blood circulation from the pancreas when your glucose level is high. I repeat again, when your glucose level is high in the blood circulation, then insulin will be released. Then the question is, when the glucose level will be high in the blood circulation? When you consume diet, with considered breakfast or lunch or dinner, whatever it may be, when you consume the food, automatically the glucose level in the blood will increase. So that means when you consume the diet, then automatically insulin is supposed to release and then it will try to push the glucose molecules into the cell. And there was one myth that the insulin will push all the glucose molecules into the cell. It's not true. Actually, very few molecules of glucose will be pushed by the insulin from the blood to cell. Very few, actually. Negligible, actually. But that is the initiation. That means starting. So insulin will initiate the movement of the glucose from the blood to cell, but it will not push each and every glucose molecule from the blood to cell. So this concept you have to understand. But the problem is, if it will initiate And next, you have to put some effort to push the glucose molecule from blood to cell. Then if you are expecting that insulin should push each and every glucose molecule from blood to cell, then you are inviting diabetes. That's all. Insulin cannot push each and every glucose molecule from blood to cell. So you should understand that it will push only few molecules of glucose from blood to cell. And if you are expecting that insulin should push each and every glucose molecule from blood to cell, and you are thinking like that, your imagination is like that, your work culture is like that, then it is understood that very soon you are going to become diabetic. That is one point. And most important reason, stress. High levels of stress. Now everybody is talking about this stress. So stress is one particular important factor, so which actually causes the diabetes. Not because insulin is not working. It is because of, once you are under stress, I think you studied about corticosteroids, glucocorticoids, mineralocorticoids, etc., etc. Glucocorticoids will start to dominate. Once glucocorticoids start to dominate, start to dominate when you are under stress condition, that hormones will be released into the body. Once it start to get released, then automatically it is understood that it is going to suppress the insulin. Once it not only it will suppress the insulin, it is going to suppress your immune system also. That means when you are under stress, so you are going to do harm to two important things in your body. One is you are suppressing your insulin. Second one, you are suppressing your immune system. So that is one of the most important factor why most of the people, they are suffering from diabetes. So we are not bothered about what is the cause of diabetes nowadays. We just talk about insulin. And there is no point in discussing about insulin without discussing the root problem. The root problem is something different. So why I am diabetic? That question is important. But the problem is nobody is interested to talk about why you are diabetic. They say that you are diabetic, that means you take this medicine. It's not the right approach. First, we have to understand why I am diabetic. That means it is understood that you have to understand that every diabetic individual is different. The root cause for the diabetes is different from individual to individual. The problem is nobody is interested to know where the problem is, why that individual is suffering from diabetic. Individual analysis is not there. Just we discuss about the whole concept and we will say that the person is diabetic. You just observe this slide, then you can understand. High blood glucose level. So high blood glucose level is there. Then automatic release of insulin from beta cells of pancreas. What it will do, you just check. It promotes the glucose uptake into cell. Yeah, definitely it promotes the movement of the glucose into the cell from the blood and withdraw of glucose from the blood. Automatically, the blood glucose level will come down. Promotes the glucose storage in the liver and muscle. Already you studied in biochemistry that synthesis of glycogen from glucose in muscle and as well as liver. So this hormone, insulin, will promote glycogenesis, synthesis of glycogen from glucose. So once the synthesis of glycogen is started in the liver and muscle, automatically your glucose level will come down in the blood. Then inhibits gluconeogenesis. So already you heard about neogenesis, synthesis of glucose from non-carbohydrate sources, that is protein and lipid. It will not allow the formation of gluconeogenesis, that means synthesis of glucose from non-carbohydrate sources. That means when it is preventing the synthesis of glucose, then it is understood that your glucose level will come down. Inhibits glycogenolysis. Glycogenolysis means breakdown of glycogen to give glucose. So glycogenolysis will take place in the liver. Of course, it will take place in the muscle, but it will lead to one more pathway called as glycolysis. So we are concentrating only in the liver. Inhibits glycogenolysis, breakdown of glycogen to glucose. That also will be inhibited by the insulin. Then automatically it is understood it will decrease the blood glucose level. And most importantly, promotes lipogenesis. Means promotes the formation of lipids from carbohydrate rich food. So that means when you consume a lot of amount of food, then don't think that all the glucose molecules will be entering into the liver or muscle. 40% of the glucose will be stored in the form of fat, that is lipid. So that will get deposited in the adipose tissue. That means whether you consume fat, whether you don't consume fat, when you consume carbohydrate, it is understood that 40% of the carbohydrate, immediately it will be stored in the form of fat. So that means this is normal concentration. If it is stored more than 40%, consider some 45% or 50%, you will be obese, little bit bulky or healthy. And if it is stored less than 40%, consider some 35% or 30%, you will look, even though you consume a lot of amount of carbohydrate, you look very lean because more amount of, what I can say, less amount of the glucose will be stored in the fat. So this is a tricky point here. So when you consume more, when the body stores less amount of carbohydrate, like in the form of fat, that means, yeah, your fat content will be less, but the thing is glucose content will be very high in the blood. A second thing. So why this body is converting this glucose into fat? Because body cannot trust you. It want to synthesize the fat and it will want to store that particular fat to cover the vital organs of the body. For example, some important organs are there, like liver and as well as kidney. So it want to protect that particular area. So that's why constantly it will take the glucose and it will convert into fat and it will store that particular fat as the covering to the liver and as well as kidney. These are the two most vulnerable organs in the body. It requires high levels of protection. So that's why if you see the liver and as well as kidney, it is protected really superbly with the fat. A lot of amount of fat will be deposited surrounding the liver and as well as fat. So that's why this 40% of the fat which is stored in the, which is collected from the glucose, is stored in the form of fat. This also will decrease the glucose level in the blood. And finally, so you will experience the decrease in blood glucose level. So many advantages are there in this by this particular point. This is about the insulin in brief. So any questions are there, and you can, what is that, ask. You can unmute yourself and you can ask the questions. Yes, any questions, please? Any questions? Any questions is there?
No, sir.
Shall I wind up?